Hello, everyone, and welcome to the CyberWire's Research Saturday, presented by Juniper Networks. I'm Dave Bittner, and this is our weekly conversation with researchers and analysts, tracking down threats and vulnerabilities and solving some of the hard problems of protecting ourselves in a rapidly evolving cyberspace. Thanks for joining us. And now a word about our sponsor, Juniper Networks. Organizations are constantly evolving and increasingly turning to multi-cloud to transform IT. Juniper's connected security gives organizations the ability to safeguard users, applications, and infrastructure by extending security to all points of connection across the network. Helping defend you against advanced threats, Juniper's connected security is also open so you can build on the security solutions and infrastructure you already have. Secure your entire business from your endpoints to your edge and every cloud in between with Juniper's connected security. Connect with Juniper on Twitter or Facebook. And we thank Juniper for making it possible to bring you Research Saturday. And thanks also to our sponsor, Envail, whose revolutionary Zero Reveal solution closes the last gap in data security, protecting data in use. It's the industry's first and only scalable commercial solution enabling data to remain encrypted throughout the entire processing lifecycle. Imagine being able to analyze, search, and perform calculations on sensitive data all without ever decrypting anything, all without the risks of theft or inadvertent exposure. What was once only theoretical is now possible with Envail. Learn more at envail.com.
Well, we're doing some research in our labs in the domain of medical security. So that is, you know, security of networks here and devices, and that you find hospitals and other healthcare institutions.
That's Israel Mirsky. He's a cybersecurity researcher and project manager at Ben-Gurion University. The research we're discussing today is titled CTGAN, Malicious Tampering of 3D Medical Imagery Using Deep Learning.
At the outset of this research, we took a look at the possible attack vectors and enumerated all the different kinds of attacks and motivations an attacker would have on attacking healthcare. And one of the subjects that we identified was altering medical scans. So that's the first one, or not one of the first ones, but it was one of the ones that we looked into.
So you decide that this is an area that you're going to look into. Where do you begin?
Well, the very first step was to understand what, you know, a doctor would look at. And we had several different use cases of what kind of medical scans that we'd like to target and identify if it were possible to alter, just as an initial use case to see if it's possible to, you know, do this attack on other kinds of medical scans. So the first one that I took a look at was lung cancer. And the typical way of analyzing and diagnosing lung cancer is through CT scans.
And so did you begin by looking at existing CT scans? I understand you did some machine learning training with existing images. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. So basically, I mean, I think that what I'll do is I'll give a little bit of background and then I'll jump right into the threat. So basically, MRIs and CT scanners are used throughout the healthcare industry for diagnosing many different kinds of medical conditions. So for example, MRIs are used to diagnose issues with bone, joint, ligament, cartilage, and herniated discs, and these kinds of problems, where CT scans are used to diagnose cancer, heart disease, and so on and so forth. These systems are connected to networks called PACS, which are basically regular Ethernet networks. PACS stands for Picture Archive Communication Systems. And just like any other Ethernet network or any other computerized network, they're all vulnerable to attacks. And as part of our research, actually, we took a look at different hospitals in our country, and we also spoke to different experts from the United States as well who were dealing with these systems. And we found that they all have similar vulnerabilities. As most cases, they're separated from the internet, so an attacker can't necessarily directly connect to it from the internet. But, you know, much to our surprise, the quick showdown.io search, you can find about 2,000 medical imaging servers and like 900 PAC servers all exposed to the internet. So not every single institution is very good at blocking your medical device from being exposed. But even if they weren't exposed, you could still get in through multiple steps through the network. Yeah, you know, there's several different cases of that also as well. And even just in 2018, you find tens, maybe I think like over 70 cases of where medical records were stolen from hospitals and ransomware was installed in hospitals. And once the attacker can get inside the hospital, it's only, you know, a few more steps away to getting into the PACS network itself. So that's the background. So what's the threat? So the threat is if the attacker can actually get access to medical scans or intercept medical scans, then he can manipulate them. So we're all familiar with something referred to as deepfakes. And what deepfakes are is the use of deep learning to alter the content of images to trick a human to believing some false evidence. The most popular, I should say, deepfake around on the internet now is, you know, putting somebody else's face onto another person's body. So, for example, there's a very famous video of Obama giving a speech when it's not actually Obama. And what we were also trying to show in this research is that deepfakes don't just apply to people's faces. Actually, this threat also applies to the medical community, where an attacker can actually, you know, implant false evidence, for example, a tumor growing in the person's body, or remove evidence, or remove the tumor, in order to get some sort of gain. I'll give you some examples of why an attacker would want to do this. There's several different reasons. So, for example, consider an individual or a state adversary that wants to affect some outcome of an election. So what he could do is he could add cancer to a CT scan performed on the political candidate, or remove it even to harm it, which is a lot more severe of a scenario if you think about it. There's ways of getting the, you know, the candidate or target individual to come to the CT scanner, but I won't get into that right now. Another example is maybe of ransomware. So an attacker seeks out monetary gain by holding the integrity of a medical imagery hostage. And in this case, the attacker achieves this by just altering a few scans and then demanding payment to reveal which scans have been affected. So the hospital won't really know, you know, which scans are been manipulated or not. So he doesn't need access to all the scans. He can just intercept one scan, manipulate that, prove that he's manipulated it, and now he can leverage payment. A more or less malicious case is the case of insurance fraud. So somebody can get into a car accident, you know, a very light car accident, and then intentionally alter his own medical records to receive money from insurance company. So one case could be, for example, he could add a small fracture or a very small hemorrhage in his brain to the scan, something that's very hard to refute. And you can say, this is why, you know, this is why I can't sleep at night, or this is why, you know, I'm numb down, you know, down below. And that's that. And then he can get insurance money from that. But there's many other reasons, and you know, you get, the list goes on and on. And there's, you could think of far more scarier reasons, such as assassination or even murder, and especially the threat of cyber terrorism.
You actually put some of these fakes in front of some doctors, and you were able to fool them pretty reliably.
That's right. So the process that we did actually, so we looked at the same process that is used to generate deep fakes, which is the use of GANs, generative adversarial networks. And we also took a look at the state-of-the-art techniques for detecting lung cancer. So we looked at some of the recent papers that are published on how these deep learning algorithms go through CT scans and detect cancer. And we combined both techniques to show how an attacker can actually perform the malicious side of that. So once we've got that all working, we kind of developed this framework which is called CT GAN, which can inject or remove cancer or other medical conditions from 3D medical imagery. We needed to verify that what it's generating is realistic enough, right? So if I just tamper some image and put in some blob, you know, that it could raise suspicion if it doesn't look realistic. And then, you know, the radiologist will speak to the technician and will find out very quickly that there's something afoot here. Hmm. So what we did was we hired three radiologists, and the radiologists were given in a blind test, meaning we didn't tell them that this was part of any cybersecurity research or anything like that. They thought it was just a medical test. And we gave them 70 scans to look at, where the 70 scans were a mix of actual scans, having cancer or not having cancer, and tampered scans with our CT GAN framework, which had either fake injected cancer or real cancer removed from the lungs. In this blind test, we found that when it comes to injecting cancer, 99% of the time, the radiologists thought it was true cancer. And for removing cancer, 94% of the time, radiologists did not detect the cancer and gave the patient a clean bill of health. And then that proceeded to the next stage where we said, okay, what happens if we educate the radiologists and we tell them about this attack? Do they stand a chance at finding anything malicious here? At least for one case, at least one of the radiologists, he improved his scores much better, but it still was not able to accurately differentiate between a tampered scan and a regional scan. So even in that case, for all the radiologists together, We found that when it comes to trying to figure out if cancer, whether it be real cancer or fake cancer, radiologists had about 61% accuracy, and from an actual clean body and a like a healthy body versus a tampered image that also looks like it's a healthy body, even worse, just 39% accuracy. And we took this one step further. So we said, if we can trick the radiologists, the humans, what about, you know, the whole aspect of adversarial machine learning, which is the concept of being able to attack machine learning algorithms. And so what we did is we downloaded a state-of-the-art AI, deep learning AI for performing lung cancer screening that won the 2017 Kaggle competition, $1 million competition. And we used the exact same model that they trained, and we showed that pretty much 100% of the time we can fool this model and make it think that there is cancer or that there isn't cancer.
Wow. So it's not just the human element that you're capable of fooling here.
Yes, that's correct. And that's a concern because a lot of radiologists actually use, well, not a lot of, I don't know about exact numbers, but I do know there are hospitals and clinics which use advanced AI tools, which help them analyze the scans, to help them annotate the scans and detect where potential cancer may be. So if a radiologist relies on these tools, then we can fool these tools. That means that the attacker has a greater chance of succeeding.
Now, what's going on behind the scenes here within these networks that it makes them open to these sorts of attacks?
So in our research, we identified many different attack vectors. There's so many ways that an attacker can get into a network. And we also showed, by the way, how this malware could be completely autonomous. So the attacker doesn't even need to be present or connected to the bot to be able to cause the manipulation. It just, you know, can search for the patient's ID or patient's name and then completely, you know, autonomously manipulate the scan. So it could be that the attacker is able to infect the DICOM viewer. DICOM is the format for 3D medical scan. So he infected the radiologist's viewing application and then in real time can alter the image. It could be that, you know, the attacker came in physically onto premises and was able to install a man middle device or, you know, connect to one of the computers and install his malware there. Or he could, you know, he can connect to the hospital's Wi-Fi and try and propagate through the internal network or infiltrate the network from the internet. And in all these different cases, the attacker is essentially trying to plant his malware somewhere between the entire diagnosis process. So where the CT scanner makes the scan and then it's uploaded to a storage server. And then from there, where it's sent to the radiologist to perform the diagnosis. So anywhere along that pipeline, the attacker wants to plant his malware to perform his attack. Now, the reason why it's so successful, this is a very loaded question. General healthcare is kind of behind when it comes to cybersecurity, at least behind in with respect to other industries. And there are several reasons for that. I don't remember the exact year when it became policy in legislation for HIPAA, which HIPPA, which requires hospitals to protect information in terms of security. And this has, you know, been coming more and more into play as hospitals are trying to secure their systems. But for the most part, you know, medical staff is more likely that they're focused on saving lives and being HIPAA compliant, meaning they're going to make sure the data doesn't go outside the hospital. It's only going to be shared with people that it should be shared with. But when it comes to the internal network itself, you know, that attackers shouldn't have access to, or anybody shouldn't have access to in the first place, right? It's supposed to be somewhat air-gapped. You know, you can tell that they can be kind of lenient in that regard. And their focus is elsewhere. It's on the threats coming from the internet, for example. Right. So that's one reason why there are so many vulnerabilities. But there's another reason is because a lot of medical systems are kind of outdated, obsolete systems are there for either a backup or compatibility reasons. And for that reason, now you have lots of different components, old scanners, databases, and you know, services that are all connected inside the hospital, which have plenty of vulnerabilities or may not even be kept anymore.
And there's a general lack of use of encryption throughout?
Yeah, so actually to show that this entire attack vector is a serious threat, not just the fact that we can change the imagery, but an attacker can manipulate the imagery and get his hands on the imagery, we actually performed a covert penetration test on a hospital. Part of this pen test, we got permission from the hospital, and what I did actually is I went in during the night, and I waited for the cleaning staff to open the doors. And I went in, and cleaning staff didn't mind I was there. They didn't ask any questions. I even saw plenty of doctors going by, and they just didn't ask any questions. And I just walked around like I belonged there, and I found a CT scanner, and I was able to install a small Raspberry Pi between the CT scanner and the rest of the PAX network so that I can intercept all the traffic. And I also can have a backdoor if I wanted to into the network. And with this little device, I was really trying to figure out what kind of, how the traffic is being sent over the network, if it's being encrypted or not. If it's being encrypted properly, can I maybe capture some doctor's credentials? And actually, after like something like 3 minutes, I got the credentials for like 27 different doctors and medical staff members on site. But wow. Aside from that, actually, I found that the scans were being sent over the network unencrypted. And apparently, this is something that happens in most hospitals around the world. And I spoke to engineers from Mayo Clinic, and I spoke to the same software providers for this hospital, which serves about 2,000, over 2,000 installations worldwide to hospitals worldwide. And one of the main reasons for this is, again, the issue of compatibility. So you have one system in there, for example, the storage system or the information system that tracks all the appointments, and it can only, you know, handle one particular version, and there's a problem with compatibility. So they decide to not put encryption anyways, because again, the supposedly attackers don't have access to the internal network, so they're not concerned with that.
Hmm. And yet, obviously, your work there, being able to come in and attach something to the network so easily, points to the fact that that's inadequate.
That's correct. And I think that hospitals should put a little more emphasis into their security hygiene internally as well, because it's not good enough just to focus on the external security, the outer boundary of, let's say, where the, how the hospital is connected to the internet, because you're always going to have some hole somewhere, even if, you know, especially the most classic case, for example, of clicking on a link and downloading something from an email, right? So the moment somebody, an attacker gets in, it's just a free-for-all. So you have to make sure that the security inside the network is also just as secure as the security outside the network.
Yeah, and it strikes me too that, a hospital is an environment where you have lots of people coming and going, new people coming and going all the time. And so it's hard to separate a lot of that equipment physically from that parade of people coming by.
Yeah, well, actually, you do a pretty good job about that. I mean, it's not like you have like network cables hanging from the ceiling, or anybody can plug into the wall or anything like that. There's the areas where personnel should only be, and areas where patients can be, and family members can be, and they do a pretty good job of separating the physical infrastructure. But when it comes to somebody who just walks in there, especially if he's dressed to play the role, the moment he's in, then at that point, it doesn't matter anymore. Or again, there are hospitals that just simply their external security, their Wi-Fi networks for internal use are just not secured well enough. And even somebody from, from proximity can connect into the internal network.
What's the reaction been so far to this research? Has it been a bit of a wake-up call for some people?
It has, actually. I've been in contact with somebody from the FDA who's in charge of trying to ensure the hospitals are securing their medical devices and systems better. And I'm cooperating with them to help them out in this regard. A lot of different hospitals are also, I think, getting a little bit more realization about the threat. I mean, I think just recently in the RSA 2019 conference, there was some researchers who showed that the moment that an attacker is inside the hospital network, he has, full reign over everything. He can, connect to ultrasound scanners and change parameters, and it's a very serious issue. So I think that hospitals are definitely, and the medical healthcare personnel are definitely paying attention to this. And I do hope that, especially from the countermeasures that we put in our paper, that they implement some of these and try and secure the systems better.
What are some of the countermeasures that you listed in your work?
Well, the most basic countermeasure is simply to enable proper encryption. So the moment you have, end-to-end encryption across your network, then you've already mitigated the vast majority of man-middle attacks that can occur. So, but that's not doesn't mean just any link within the network. So that's the entire pipeline. So for when the scanner sends the traffic to the storage server, or when the storage server sends the data to the radiologist, every single link has to be encrypted, and of course encrypted properly with proper certificates. And another thing that hospitals can do is most software, PAC software, actually give the ability to give a digital signature on the medical scan. So when the CT scanner itself generates a scan and is about to send it over the network, you can actually sign it, and that can be verified at the endpoint in the radiologist viewer, make sure that nothing's been tampered here, that you're actually looking at an authentic original image. So even if, let's say, for example, a malware or the hacker gets into the storage server, a packed server and starts manipulating images, he won't be able to fake that signature. So the radiologist will know that something has been tampered in that image.
Our thanks to Israel Mirsky from Ben-Gurion University for joining us. The research is titled CT-GAN, Malicious Tampering of 3D Medical Imagery Using Deep Learning. We'll have a link in the show notes. We'll also have a link to a video that demonstrates what they were up to. Thanks to Juniper Networks for sponsoring our show. You can learn more at juniper.net/security or connect with them on Twitter or Facebook. And thanks to Envail for their sponsorship. You can find out how they're closing the last gap in data security at envail.com. The CyberWire Research Saturday is proudly produced in Maryland out of the startup studios of DataTribe, where they're co-building the next generation of cybersecurity teams and technology. The coordinating producer is Jennifer Iben. Our CyberWire editor is John Petrick. Technical editor Chris Russell. Our staff writer is Tim Nodar. Executive editor Peter Kilpie. And I'm Dave Bittner. Thanks for listening.